So I want to welcome everyone here to Adath Israel. It's wonderful to see so many of members of our own community, but also our guests. We welcome you. This is the first time you're coming to our synagogue. For our 2017 Sacks-Wilner Holocaust Education Program, you know, in the last few months, we've seen a dramatic increase in anti-Semitism here in this country. And many of us have been shocked to see these kinds of incidents in America. Bomb threats at JCCs, cemeteries being desecrated. These, of course, are horrific acts that must be condemned by all members of society. But one of the silver linings to this cloud of anti-Jewish activity has been the response from other faith communities. We've seen Christians and Muslims, members of many diverse religious communities, stand up and oppose bigotry. These acts of hate have brought together many different kinds of people from all different backgrounds. It's so vital that people of religious faith stand up for each other. We all need allies, we need friends who will fight for our rights and our freedoms, just as we would stand up for the rights and freedoms of others. It's incredibly moving when you see someone take a stand for you, even though they can easily keep their head down, just go about their business, not draw attention to themselves. And that's why I felt very strongly about inviting Pastor Chris Edmonds to Adath today for the 10th annual Sacks-Wilner Holocaust Education Program. I heard Pastor Edmonds tell the story of his father's heroism at last year's APAC policy conference in Washington. And I was moved by the story. So I asked him to bring that message of standing up for the other here to this community. I hope it will inspire us to have the kind of courage that his father, Master Sergeant Roddie Edmonds, showed. To take a stand when we see prejudice, hatred, or bigotry, and to continue to build a society that values freedom and equality. One that will never have to witness the horrors of the Holocaust. I want to take this opportunity to thank a number of people who helped make today possible. First, to Linda and Steve Gallen for their dedication to educating everyone, not just Jews, but non-Jews as well, about the Holocaust. We're so grateful to the commitment that you made to create this program over 10 years ago. I also want to thank our planning committee that consisted of Bill Davis, our president Stephanie Loesberg, Michelle Pressman, Deborah Raven, Shelley Shaw, Lisa Snyder, and Pam Zeigman. I also want to thank our wonderful staff, our Hazan, our Kaplan, Anna Sophia, Kitchen, Anina Rutherford, Julia Dubin, Pat Lucas, Greg Fabian, and Rolando Chia and his crew. To Laurel Cantor for graphic design and Paul Schindel of Green Bears for their printing services. Janet Cohen for photography. We also have Abe Abramovich doing some videography for us. I also want to thank Jerry Ennis for writing a press release, and Bernice Abramovich for the PR, brought such a wonderful group here this evening. I also want to thank someone who's not here, Stanley Stahl, who is the executive director of the Jewish Foundation for the Righteous. She was a previous Sacks-Wilner speaker here at Adath, and she was able to connect me to Pastor Edmonds. I want to make a special mention of Rabbi Daniel Grossman, our Rabbi Emeritus, who was instrumental in bringing the Sacks-Wilner program to Adath and also to Heather Morton, who's here today, who created 9 wonderful events preceding this one. We're so blessed to be building on your success. Lastly, I want to thank the Jewish Family and Children's Service of Greater Mercer County for their generous support for today's program. In particular, I want to thank my wife, Lisa Adler, of JFCS, for all of her help in making this program possible. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Michelle Nathel, the Executive Director of the JFCS. Master Chris Edmonds, who is the son of World War II hero Master Sergeant Roddie Edmonds, whose fearless bravery saved the lives of Jewish American soldiers in a prisoner of war camp in Germany. Sergeant Edmonds' incredible story and Chris's improbable journey to discover it is inspiring millions to make heroic choices every day. As founder of Roddie's Code, Pastor Chris is committed to extending the legacy of leadership, and Sergeant Edmonds' inspiring story to create heroes everywhere. Pastor Chris is a sought-after speaker who serves as senior pastor of Piney Grove Baptist Church in Maryville, Tennessee. Chris has a business degree from the University of Tennessee, a master's from Liberty University, and teaches executive leadership for the Department of Defense. He and his high school sweetheart, Regina, are blessed with three amazing daughters, awesome sons-in-law, and seven of the coolest grandchildren. There might be some disagreement here. But it is my great pleasure to introduce and to invite up Pastor Chris Edmonds this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi. It's always dangerous when a preacher puts a microphone in his hand. I promise I won't take up a collection tonight. So good evening. Are you glad you're here?
Yes.
Yes. Awesome. Yeah, give yourself a hand. That's good. Yeah. It's a great honor to be with you. And clapping is appropriate. If you feel like clapping about Dad and his story and the men that he served with, that's absolutely appropriate. Do that. If you feel like jumping up and leaving, do that. Do that quietly. It is a great honor to be with you. Never been to this part of New Jersey. Now I'm going to tell all of my friends, I went to Princeton. Actually went to the University of Tennessee. So this is an awesome community. I feel the love in this community and in this family. That's what we need. That's amazing. And so thank you for, particularly Rabbi and Ms. Lisa, thank you for your wonderful care and all the people that you've connected to take care of me. A host of people that have taken care of me. But before I begin, I really want to correct something that the rabbi said. Where I come from, it's not Maryville, Tennessee. It's Merle. So look at somebody next to you and go, Merle. Now look at some, just kind of look at a bunch of people and say, how y'all doing?
How y'all doing?
We got some Southerners in the room. That's good. Well, congratulations. You are now genuine East Tennessee Hillbillies. Welcome to the family. By the way, I had notes to keep me on track, but I've lost those at this point. I'm just going to continue. So, love makes our world a better and brighter place. When we choose to be our brother's keeper. And that's what you're going to hear in the story. We're going to celebrate love tonight. We're going to celebrate life tonight. Because this evening I have a story to share with you that celebrates both of those. It's a powerful story of bravery forged during evil, evil days. We will be reminded of the 6 million innocent Jewish lives who were taken, murdered by an evil regime. We will be reminded of the 1.5 million precious children, Jewish children who never got to grow up and experience the wonder and joy of life. In the midst of that darkness, we will see a light and lights. Beautiful lights that drive the darkness away. And that's the story. One of the stories you'll hear tonight. There were many of those lights. There weren't many as many as needed, but there were many of those lights. We have some lights in our room tonight. We have some Holocaust survivors who are here tonight with us. If you're a Holocaust survivor, would you please stand? We want to honor you as well. Love you. We thank you for your service. So I'm going to share this story of bravery. story of an ordinary life lived well. Just an ordinary life lived well that was extraordinary, even heroic. And I hope that this story will inspire you to live heroic as well. That it will help you, that you will see the fearless faith that is required for us in order to love others and required for us to make a difference in this world. The uncommon righteousness that you will see. I love this story because it's a human story. How many humans we got in the house? Ordinary, everyday people. Moms, dads, grandparents, young people, we're all ordinary. It's also an American story. I love that. Love Americans. It's a Jewish story. You like that? You better. It's a Christian story. It is a soldier's story. More than anything, it's God's story. I don't believe that this story would have even come to my attention had it not been for the sovereign will of God to reveal it. For such a time as this, if there's ever been a time for this story to be revealed, it is today, while we're dealing with it. But guess what? It's everyone's story. So it's your story, and it's my story. My story begins with an old diary. Just a weather fragile book. The diary belonged to a young man, my father, from Tennessee. He was fighting for his country on a continent near the edge of collapse. And he passed away years earlier. Matter of fact, 1985. Since then, his diary just remained tucked away with other mementos of Dad's time during World War II. He had served with distinction. Master Sergeant Roddie Edmonds of the 106th Infantry was captured in the Battle of Bulge and spent 100 harsh, harsh days in two German POW camps toward the end of the war. Now, this was the story our family knew. To us, it was the totality of his service. He served, he was captured, he came home alive. That's about all we knew. While reading Dad's diary that evening, many, many years after his passing, I was very moved by the words in his diary. In it, he wrote this: a lot of things I'm not going to write. Go to the next slide. A lot of things I'm not going to write because they aren't exactly nice to talk about. I know God was with us, and he answered our prayers. Now listen to this. I learned men even better than before. Some were good, some were bad, some were better, some were worse. Dad's diary inspired me to look further into his time in his service and to uncover the true story of his time as a prisoner of war. So late one evening, I Googled his name and rank on the internet. And remarkably, his name appeared in an article about President Nixon entitled Richard Nixon's Search for New York Home. Well, what is Dad's name doing in this article in the New York Times about President Nixon? And it tells the story of an attorney from New York who sold his historic townhouse to the president in the 1970s because no one else wanted him to be their neighbor. Go figure. And this gentleman by the name of Lester Tanner, who you'll meet later through the Marvel video, sold his townhouse to the president. And in the middle of the article, he mentioned my dad's bravery along with his name, and they spell his name right, so no one's my dad. So what do you think happens to me at that moment? Proud. What?
Proud.
I'm very proud, and I'm like, what did Dad do? Who is Lester Tanner? Where does he live? Is he still alive? I gotta find out. So that began my journey. And so I met Lester, who tells me the story. You'll hear more about that in the video. But Dad was the highest ranking soldier at Stalag 9A, a POW camp near Ziegenhain, Germany. It was a camp for non-commissioned officers. It was near the end of the war, late January 1945. Even in the POW camps, the Nazis had strict anti-Jew policies, and they segregated Jewish soldiers from non-Jews. Most of the time, sending them to murderous labor camps like Bergen. Well, the army told the Jewish soldiers to destroy their dog tags and never mention their Jewish identity if they happened to fall into enemy hands. So late on the evening of January 26, 1945, my father receives orders from the major, the commandant of the camp. And it said to only send out the Jewish men at the following morning's roll call. Without hesitation, Dad turned to his men and he said, "We're not doing that. Tomorrow morning we all fall out." That's what they did. It was bitterly cold that morning, January 27, 1945. As the ruthless commander approached, he absolutely was stunned. He could not believe his eyes. All of the Americans, all of those non-commissioned officers, nearly 1,300 soldiers were standing in sharp formation. Well, the Nazi, he raced over to my father and he angrily says, "They cannot all be Jews." To which my father calmly replied, "We are all Jews here." Don't you love that line? Where did he get that? That is great. Well, the Nazi officer turned blood red. He would have none of that. He pulled out his Luger. He put it hard into my dad's forehead. Pressed it hard. He said, "Sergeant, one last chance. You will order the Jewish Americans to step forward, or I will shoot you right now." Well, by this time, Dad and his men had faced untold horrors. Brutal battle, the Battle of the Bulge, the worst and bloodiest battle of World War II. A death march. One of the POWs told me, "If you didn't march, you didn't make it." Bombing while imprisoned in a boxcar. Left for dead on Christmas Eve, December 24th, 1944. Several of the POWs were killed, including Dad's chaplain. 40 days of starvation, where the men were losing, on average, 1 pound per day. Had they stayed in the camp even 30 days longer from the time they were liberated, doctors at Camp Lucky Strike told the men they would have, most of them would have died of starvation. He'd been beaten, shot, kicked, punched with a rifle, bitten by dogs, suffered humiliation is the only thing Dad would ever tell me. "Son, I'd rather not talk about it. We were humiliated." Very inhuman conditions. Just 2 days earlier from this moment where Dad's standing with a gun to his head, they marched the Americans outside, have them stand in the cold all day, and forced them to witness the brutal execution of a young Russian soldier. And they were all told, "If you disobey our orders, the same will happen to you." Yet there Dad stands, strong, fearless, resolute. Finally, Dad spoke. He said, "Major, if you shoot me, you'll have to shoot us all. Because we know who you are. And you'll stand for war crimes when we win this war. And you will pay." Lester tells me the major blanched. And time seemed to freeze. And then the major's arm began to tremble. And then just as suddenly, the major pulled the weapon to his side, placed it in his holster, turned, and marched back to his quarters, never to ask for the Jewish men to be segregated again. You can clap. That deserves it. This does too. Dad saved the lives of nearly 200 Jewish Americans that day. Well, last year, I had the privilege of visiting Israel, and what a dream come true for a pastor. My first visit. And I was invited to Yad Vashem, where they announced, along with the nation of Israel, that Dad would join the righteous among the nations. That is an amazing honor. You know, righteous among the nations is the highest award given by the nation of Israel to non-Jews for rescuing Jews during the Holocaust. I'm so glad Dad did what he did. He did the right thing. The historic ceremony was held at the Israeli Embassy in Washington and hosted by Ambassador Dermer. It was the first time in the history of the righteous that the award was given at the Israeli Embassy in America. Attending were Rabbi Lau. What an honor to have him there. My Tennessee senators, I don't know about that. No, I'm just kidding. They're great guys. Don't tell them I said that. Are you recording? No. And Prime Minister Netanyahu Skyped in and spoke live. It's like he's right there. It's like, it was so cool. Also attending was special guest of honor, President Barack Obama. I was already shaking in my boots because I knew I was going to have to speak before the president. But then I get a phone call from Yad Vashem the morning of the event. And they say, oh, we've got one more person to add to the agenda. They're going to speak after you, and then the president's going to speak. I said, oh, great. Who is it? Steven Spielberg. Oh, wow. President bring his, one of his best buddies, Steven Spielberg, along. I said, okay, now I'm really scared to death. So I guess I can take warming up the crowd for the president, Mr. Spielberg, off of my bucket list. I was never on there, but anyway. Well, the unprecedented ceremony took place, get this, if you don't believe there's a God, there is a God. It took place on January 27, 2016, exactly 71 years to the day of what Dad did on that fateful morning. Well, Dad was honored as only the fifth American, to be named among the righteous, and the first U.S. soldier to receive the award. And get this, Yad Vashem told me that he's the first to save American Jews. Isn't that great? It was a remarkable evening. Incredible. So I hope the next remarkable ceremony will take place at the White House to present Dad the Congressional Medal of Honor. That would be so incredible. I think he deserves it. How about you? He's also, just recently, like 3 weeks ago, there's a bipartisan group of senators, including my two senators, Senators Jim Kaine, Senator Ben Cardin, have recommended Dad for the Congressional Gold Medal, which is the highest civilian award as well. So that's also a part of it. And then in about 4 weeks, I'm going to L.A. And I had gotten word from Simon Wiesenthal Center that they're going to honor Dad. They'll give him a Medal of Valor at their annual dinner, along with Shimon Peres. So I'm so grateful. And there's been other awards, but you know, my family and I are very, very proud of Dad. We were proud of Dad before we knew all this. Great Dad. Loved us, loved God, loved his country. He would have loved you well. You would have enjoyed hanging out with him. And so we're grateful for the decisions he made and the righteous choices, particularly that he made that day. Blessed to learn his story. Last March, as Rabbi said, I had the incredible honor to speak to 18,000 people at the Verizon Center for APAC. Is that, how cool is that? It was amazing, electric. I'm so glad there are so many people across this country that stand for what's right, that stand for Israel, that stand for the Jewish community, and say, we're gonna stand no matter what. I tell a bunch of my buddies, you know, I opened the same week in the Verizon Center as Rihanna did. Just as amazing was visiting Israel just a few weeks ago, back in December, to meet with Prime Minister Netanyahu, to personally thank the nation of Israel for this incredible honor. I shared that our family is so grateful to the nation for honoring Dad the way they have. And I also shared that we believe as a family that this is the highest honor Dad will receive this side of eternity. Righteous among the nations. And I also shared with him that we stand with Israel, that me and millions of other Christians stand with our Jewish brothers and sisters and the nation of Israel, and we will always stand with you. We love you and we will stand with you. My greatest blessing, meeting some of the men and the families that saved. Sonny Fox of California, he's got the light blue tie on. And I've got to pause here just to ask, did anybody grow up watching Wonderama? That's Sonny Fox, the Sonny Fox. So I want a group picture of all the Wonderama kids. I could send it to Sonny. Okay? Sonny was in the camp with Dad. Incredible guy. He's still Mr. Entertainment. He's wonderful. Hope to see him in LA when we go out there. Lester Tanner of New York. He's got the purple tie on. Lester is an amazing individual. When I'm talking to teenagers, I say he's the bomb diggity. You know what I'm talking about? Paul Stern of Virginia. He's sitting. Ever get this right. He's sitting in the front. Do you recognize the gentleman behind him? That's Ambassador Ron Durbin. Paul's lovely wife, Corinne, and that other guy that's standing there. Not pictured are Hank Friedman of Georgia, and also Steve Friedman of Cleveland of blessed memory. Just remember the Friedman family. Skip passed away last week. It's a very sad time for us, but we also rejoice in the life that he lived and the light that he shone through his life. I love these men. I love their families. Now get this. All these Jewish families have adopted a Southern Baptist preacher into their family. That, a little scary for the rabbis, but it's pretty good. These men served their country well during World War II. And they faced the same hellish POW camps as Dad. And they stood there with Dad. They followed his leadership. And their victory over the horrors of war didn't defeat them, but rather inspired them to come back home, return to America, finish college, marry their sweethearts, raise families, be ordinary citizens of extraordinary influence. Great men, great families. I love them. So my dad's legacy are these men and their families, and their children, and their grandchildren, and their great-grandchildren. Thousands of people are alive and well today because of the righteous choice Dad made. I want you to meet these men. Not all of them, but several of them. Through the marvel of video, I want you to hear more of the story from them. It's about a 14-minute video.
My My father passed away in August of 1985. I was 26 years old. You know, my father, he never really talked about his experiences in World War II or his time as a prisoner of war. He would say, "Son, there's some things I'd rather not talk about." While my father was a prisoner of war, he kept a diary. Late one night after reading his diary, I Googled his name and rank, and the first link that came up was an article in the New York Times.
I was being interviewed by the New York Times in 2008. All of a sudden, I remembered that there was a Master Sergeant Roddie Edmonds who saved my life when he defied the Germans and POW camp. That's all I said.
In the middle of that article, Lester mentions the bravery and courage of his Master Sergeant Roddie Edmonds. And I said, I got to find out what really happened to my dad during his POW experience.
I was born in the Bronx on August 8, 1923.
January 27, 1924.
I was born in Cleveland on April 24, 1924.
June 17, 1925 in Brooklyn, New York. I got the draft notice shortly after I turned 18, and I reported in for the draft exam, and they found me totally acceptable. I was breathing.
I was 18 years old. I was assigned as a combat medic to care for the wounded soldiers on the battlefield.
I was in headquarters company of the 422nd Infantry Regiment of the 106th Division. And that's where I met Les Tanner.
And I was Sergeant Lester Tannenbaum of the headquarters company. And Roddie Edmonds was the master sergeant. Roddie grew up in Knoxville, Tennessee. He probably never met a Jew in Tennessee when he went into the Army.
My dog tag had the information on it, my name and my serial number, and the letter H for Hebrew, so that if they found our bodies, they would know how to bury us.
One of the things we were told, that if we were captured, we should destroy our dog tags.
Because being a Jew in that circumstance, we didn't know what our future was.
And off we went to the front. We went over as replacements for filling up the slots that had been opened by casualties. It was December, it was snowy, it was the coldest winter in 50 years.
We replaced the 2nd Division on the front, right in the Siegfried Line, on the German side of the border.
We were very vulnerable.
The men had come and were told that this was a quiet sector. And when they got here, just 6 days after they got here, the war came to them.
The first day of the attack was December 16th.
I awakened and heard shell fire.
St. Vith was being attacked. That's our division headquarters, 10 miles in back of us.
We were there when the Germans broke through with the Battle of the Bulge, and they broke through in force.
They broke through north of us and south of us.
We were completely surrounded, and we knew we were cut off.
Our position was untenable, and we finally decided to make a break for it. And we are cut off and surrounded by columns of German tanks, guns, troops.
Captain Forster said, it's hopeless.
I'm reading from my father's diary that he kept. It was a hopeless cause in our case. When Captain Forster surrendered us, he did a very wise thing. Our rifles were no good against tanks and 88 fire.
And out we came to become part of what was the largest collection of captured GIs in World War II, from the 106th, from the 28th, and others. We began to start our march to we didn't know where.
There was a concern that the Germans would just shoot us up. When you're in brutal hands, like the Germans were, you're scared as hell.
I particularly was concerned because my name was obviously Jewish.
And then we got to the railhead, Gerald Stein.
They loaded us on boxcars.
We were packed like sardines in that boxcar. No food or water on the 4-day trip to Bad Orem.
So the boxcars we were in turned out to be exactly the same cars that were taking the Jews to concentration camps.
And we went further into Germany.
Boarded train, Thursday, 21 December, 44. Arrived Stalag 9B, Bad Orb, Monday, 25, December 44. Registered Tuesday, 26, December 44.
We had to register. Name, rank, serial number.
But then they start asking questions about your religion.
The Germans segregated the Jewish POWs.
And we were assigned to the Jewish barracks.
A special barracks surrounded by barbed wire within the prison. We were in a prison within the prison. The order came down one day that the non-commissioned officers were getting on trucks and were being taken to another camp.
They took all the sergeants and corporals, all the non-commissioned officers, whether they were Jewish or not.
And luckily, I am taken out of that isolated place at Bad Orb, and the next thing I know, I'm on a train going to Ziegenhain.
The Jewish POWs who had been left behind were shipped to a slave labor camp.
All of them later were sent to Berger, and many of them died there.
Arrived Stalag 9A, Friday, 26, January 45.
I'm walking along Main Street of Stalag 9A, Ziegenhain. People are living here, even today. It's really hard to imagine that these barracks still stand almost intact the way that they were when Dad and his men were here.
British were there, French were there, Russians were there, and now we were coming in to occupy a quadrant of that whole thing.
There were about 1,200 American prisoners. Of the 1,200, I would estimate maybe 200 were Jewish.
In Ziegenhain, in my barracks, Lester was in it, Paul was in it, Roddie was in it.
So there's about 240 men in the barracks. You were given one thin blanket. That was all you had.
You went to bed hungry, you got up hungry, you were hungry forever.
Dinner was a piece of bread. We had 10 men sharing one loaf of ersatz bread. So it was probably half flour and half sawdust.
I lost 60 pounds in 3 months. It was January 27, 1945, when the Germans announced that all Jewish American prisoners would fall out the following morning, just them. Anyone who didn't fall out would be shot. Same thing that they had said at Bad Orb. Roddie, for the first time in his experience, was in complete command. There was no one there to give him orders. It was his decision. He said, "We're not going to do that. Everyone is going to fall out, just as we do every morning." That following morning, Roddie is standing at the head of formation, and I was standing by his side.
I was there, the German was there, and Lester was there. So I heard every word that the commandant said.
Major Siegmund comes up to Roddie, and he says, "You can't all be Jews." And Roddie said, "We are all Jews."
That famous line, "We're all Jews here," that will live in Jewish history.
Takes out his Luger and puts it next to Roddy's forehead, and he says, "You will order the Jews to step forward, or I will shoot you right now." And Roddie said to him, "Major, you can shoot me, you can shoot all of us, but we know who you are, and this war is almost over, and you'll be a war criminal." And with that, the major lowered his Luger, about-faced, went back to his headquarters.
We were able to track the war pretty closely, even as we were POWs. So we knew we were within days of being liberated, hopefully.
The German commanders informed Roddie that they were going to evacuate the camp.
They don't want to be around when the Americans come.
And under Roddie's leadership, we refused. And that's why I'm here to tell you about the story today.
Roddie said, "We're just too weak to go on a long march."
We were in such lousy shape. The chances of coming out of that alive are not good.
Nobody marches out of camp. you break ranks and you run back into the barracks. And you keep doing that all day.
The day dawns, and in come the Germans. House, house!
Rouse, getting up, going back and forth.
We can see the British are moving out. Everybody else is moving out. We're still standing there. Finally, they give up, the Germans.
The German officers came up to Roddie and said, okay, camp is yours. And they marched out. We were left alone in the camp.
It gets very quiet. So now I climb up, a few of us climb up on the roof of our barracks. And then we see two lines of tanks.
We were liberated on March 30th by an American armored group.
The 6th Armored Division, as it turns out.
They were amazed to see these American soldiers, thin, hungry. So it was such a happy day.
We were liberated on March 30th, which was the second day of Passover.
And every time I ran a Seder, I would make this point because it was the date of my freedom.
I've made new friends and lost some. I don't know whether all my boys are alive or not, but I pray that they are. It all seems sort of a bad dream.
Well, they took us to Camp Lucky Strike, and I lost track of Roddie, and I never saw him again after that day. But it was never out of my mind. I have to tell you, that experience and Roddie was a defining experience of my life.
Roddie was incredible. He never really got his recognition except among us.
We were very lucky to have him with us.
That such people can exist gives you hope maybe for humanity.
We stood there, we were the witnesses. We were the witnesses.
I've been following the footsteps of my father, and it's led me here. The lives of 200 Jewish men were forever changed right here.
It wasn't only my life. Our lives multiplied. I have 4 children. I have 6 grandchildren. I have 2 great-grandchildren. So how would I have 18 people that wouldn't be here without him? Multiply that by 200, and you can see how important that decision has been.
That's the biggest joy for me, is to see the real people, the lives that have been touched and changed.
Roddie could no more have turned over any of his men to the Nazis than he could stop breathing. He just couldn't do it. A righteous man.
And then we'll take question and answer. It's a fitting tribute to Dad. Dad was a sincere Christian. His faith was his driving. He had an infectious love for everyone. Didn't matter who they were, didn't matter where they came from, didn't matter what they believed. He loved everybody. The cool thing about that is they loved him back. And he joins a small minority of just ordinary people. Remember, I told we're all ordinary. small minority of ordinary people who mustered extraordinary courage to stand and uphold the goodness and dignity of humanity. It was a defining moment. And he, rather than bowing to evil, losing his conscience and even his very soul, he refused to bow to no one. He did what was right. Right by his Creator. What he chose to do was right then, it's right now, and it will be right tomorrow. We must stand for what is right and stand against evil. And so, what drove him to do that? Well, before I go, just let me just tell you Dad's heart. His heart flowed from his faith and one eternal truth, here it is, that there is a God and God is good. And though God's love is free, it requires one essential responsibility. We must be good to one another. Or as scriptures tell us, we must love one another. Though Dad was just an ordinary man, ordinary person just like you and I, he had extraordinary powers to love others well. I want to challenge you. I'm on a mission to raise up heroes on every continent, in every country, on every street corner, through daily choices that all of us have to make. You know, until recently, I never knew Dad had a cake hanging in his car, but he did. And you do too. You have a cape hanging in your closet. And you need to pull it out, put it on. Because you're endowed with the same superpowers, extraordinary powers that Dad had. You don't believe me? You have the power to intercede for others. Tennessee Governor Bill Haslam, in a letter to the Army, said Sergeant Edmonds displayed a matchless amount of courage as he interceded for his men and defied the demands of Nazi soldiers. You and I have the power to stand against what's wrong for the good of others. We can intercede. You also have the power to influence. You don't believe that? Tickle somebody. If not, don't do that. You could do that. Lester told me this. What Roddie did made you brave. It gave you courage to do the right thing. Listen to what Lester says. When things would come, particularly when you're an attorney and you must make moral decisions, you remember what Roddie did. You take the risk. You do the right thing. Lester said it was a life-changing experience. And you saw him when he said that. And then Lester, kind of with a twinkle in his eye, says, you know, for a New York City attorney, that's kind of hard sometimes. Lester keeps that promise today. So you also have the power to inspire people for the good of others. Skip Friedman told me, I will never forget your father. He was a great man. Paul Stern says, your father's courageous actions has burned deep in my soul since that day. He adds, I will always love him. Hank Friedman said, your father's faith amazed me. I speak of him often. Lester added this, not a day goes by that I don't thank God. So you have the powers to intercede, you have the powers to influence, you have the powers to inspire. Extraordinary powers in ordinary little old you. Powers only activated when you invest them in the lives of others. So like that, I'm challenging you as I challenge myself. Invest in others. Do the right thing. Live heroic. Our dark, foreboding world is hungering for heroes. Needs heroes. Ordinary heroes like all of you. I expect to read heroic reports in New Jersey in the next week. Heroes who choose good over evil. Right over wrong. Love rather than hate. Selflessness instead of selfishness. Heroes who wake up in the morning and say, others first, me last. You know, the Talmud teaches the same, does it not? He who saves one life is as if he saved the entire world. So you know Dad was right? In war and in life, you find out who men and women really, really are. As for my dad, he's a hero. So are you. So put your cape on. Go save your world. One choice. One kindness. One smile. One loving gesture. At a time. Thank you so much for allowing me.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up. How many
many heroes were out in that courtyard or in that field that day? All of them. There are actually 1,292.
Wow.
To be exact. They were all heroes. Because here's what could have happened. See, most of these men didn't know Dad. They just knew that he was the commanding officer in those harsh conditions. They had a new guy in charge. So when he issued the orders that they would all fall out, they knew the threat because the orders were issued. If the Jewish men don't fall out, they will be shot. Well, then the other side of that question is true, too. If all of them fall out, they're probably all going to be shot. But every one of those men came out, and not one of them said, I'm not going, I'm staying in this barracks. They all went. Whatever the army was doing back then, man, they need to do it again. I mean, they followed orders. And I don't think they were just following orders just because it was the commanding officer saying he was going to do that. I really believe that they understood this truth. And they only began to understand it in the harshest of conditions. Life is not about one of us. Life is about all of us.
That's amazing.
Every one of us. And everybody fell out. And when the gun was produced and pressed into my dad's head, I'm sure the guys on the back couldn't really see that, but a lot of the guys up toward the front and in the middle could see that. They knew things are not going well at that point. Any one of those men could have said, hey, this guy's a Jew. I know he's a Jew over there. None of them knew. They all stood. Every one of them were. So, again, I'm a pastor. I think God and some angels were in that camp too, as well, at that moment. But all those men are heroes, every one of them. I'm so proud of them. Yeah. Other questions? Great questions. By the way, when I do student groups, I'm being peppered with questions. So, yes, ma'am.
First of all, as a Holocaust educator, when I do the unit on the righteous among nations, your father is for sure going to be one of them.
Thank you.
And I thank you for bringing his story to us. My other question is, what was the process? How did Yad Vashem find out about your father? Or did you contact them, or did they contact you? How did, what was the process for you to be recognized as a righteous among nations?
Again, I give credit to God. But basically, it went this way. I met Lester in New York around 2011 and came back to Knoxville with the mission to take that story to the world, really to take that story to my congressman and say, I think he should be recommended for a Medal of Honor. Well, my congressman agreed, Congressman Jimmy Duncan in Knoxville. He shared it with the two senators. They agreed. And so we formed a little team. I have a staff member from each of their offices, and we have a little team. So the process started with the Medal of Honor. We spent a year and a half putting that package together. I went back and forth through the National Archives, interviewing people, getting all the information needed, following the Army's process. We put the package together, turned it in. Well, a friend of Lester's became a friend of mine, Larry Goldstein. He lives just outside of Manhattan. And he and his wife, Parker, go to Israel at least 3 or 4 times a year. So he kept asking me for some of the material that I've been given, I was going to give to the Army. And Larry is typical New Yorker. He wants it yesterday. Great guy, I love him to death, but he wanted it yesterday. And so I gave him the material finally. And then he wants more. So I gave him some more. Well, he secretly turns it into Yad Vashem without me knowing it. Isn't that beautiful? Yeah. So finally, I'm talking to Lester. This is several months after I've turned it in. Larry still wants more stuff. So finally I said, Lester, what's up with Larry? Why does he want all this information? I know he's trying to help with the Medal of Honor, but I've given him plenty. Lester said, Chris, Larry's turned your dad's name into Yad Vashem as consideration for righteousness among the nations. He said, don't tell him I told you that. And if your dad gets it, act surprised. I said, yes, sir. But it wasn't just a few months later that Yad Vashem called me. And actually, it was the consulate general from Atlanta called me and said they had awarded it. So it was amazing, absolutely. But I had no idea that he would even be considered for that. So very, very great honor. Yes?
He deserves it.
He does, absolutely. Yes, sir.
Kind of off that last one, what do you think kept like the story for so long not being told by the other men who did have the memory of it? What kept it uncovered for so long?
Well, what I've discovered with these men and with so many like them who served in World War II is there was a great reluctance to share with family members, particularly their children. And most of those soldiers did not share with their children. And they only started opening up when the grandchildren got old enough to start drawing it out of them. Because, you know, we're putty in the hands of our grandchildren. Well, my dad died. When he died, my oldest daughter was 3 years old and my twin daughters were 6 months old. So he never had the opportunity to really relate to them and them actually draw it out of him. And Lester and Sonny and all these men I've talked to, that's been their experience. Really later in life is when they started sharing these stories. Lester was 88 when he shared that with the editor of the New York Times. And Lester's 92, I think. Is he 92 now? Yeah. By the way, Lester's nephew, right?
Wow.
Alan is here to know. We've not met before. He wanted to come and hear. Bless you, sir. You want to find out in New Jersey? It's a great place. But let's tell you a little side story about Lester and Paul. Lester and Paul met in the camp. And of course, they were starving to death. And Lester said, you've got to come, when we get out of this, you've got to come to my house and eat my mother's food. It is awesome. And so that's what happened. They get back, they get discharged from the service, and then Lester invites Paul over. Paul comes over, and there's his sister, Corinne. Paul says it was love at first sight. And Corinne says, not for me. But Paul and Corinne, still madly in love, and they're in their 90s.
Oh, wow.
No, he should have been, based on my research. He went into the service in March of 1941 before Pearl Harbor. He was a private, and he was in Fort Jackson, South Carolina, as a private. And then he went in, he was 21 years old when he went in. By the time he was 22, sometime in his 22nd year, he became a Master Sergeant, the youngest Master Sergeant appointed at the time. And he served in World War II, was discharged in December of 45, came back to Knoxville, stayed in the Guard, came back to Knoxville, worked a little bit, 2 or 3 years, and then he was called back up to the Korean War. And he was there, he was in the Korean effort for 3 years, but was actually overseas for one of those three, which was crazy. That's all before he met my mom, before I was even thought of. So he lived a lifetime before I was ever born. But he should, I don't know why he didn't stay in the military if he'd already been through that. And I don't know why he stayed in the Guard after he'd gotten out of that horrible experience as a POW. But I've got a few questions to ask him when I see him. Yes. Oh. One more question. Yeah, we got to go home tonight. One more question.
How old was your father when he made this decision?
How old do you think he was when he made this decision?
24.
He was 24 years old, and the men that you met here in this video were 19 or 20 years old. And Lester was 19. So when I met Lester in New York the first time, he says, oh, your father, he was like 33, 34. He was the old man. So Lester, he was 24. Lester almost fell out of his chair. He said, he was just 5 years older than me. I said, yes. He said, oh, he acted a whole lot more mature than we did. I said, well, he had to. Rabbi, thank you.
For sharing your father's story and your story of encountering your father's heroism and inspiring us to really understand and internalize that our actions can really make a difference. Sometimes we think, well, what can we do? How can we make a difference? But that such a brief moment in your dad's life transformed the lives of so many people, as you mentioned, not just the POWs that he saved, but the people that he influenced. And now he's influenced all these people in this room, and he will continue to influence so many more. So we are not going to forget his story here, and we also want to give you something so that you won't forget us in this community. So if you can come up. We have a gift for you, and it's not to give it away, but